Well, you're already very well behaved, because as soon as our speakers took the seats, it became as silent as a church. So thank you very much for that start. Welcome to this special debate this evening, which has been organised by the London School of Economics Hellenic Observatory. Which reminds me that any of you with mobile phones, if you could please switch them off, that would be much appreciated. Tonight's debate has, of course, received tremendous interest. And the reason for that is obvious. The fiscal crisis, which erupted in Greece last autumn, poses many challenges for Greece domestically, but it's also sent shockwaves around the financial markets, the international markets. And of course, it has confronted the Eurozone with major questions about its rules and its system of governance. So our debate tonight will focus on what Greece must do to get out of the crisis, and equally, whether in the light of the Greek crisis, the euro needs a new system of management. As I say, these issues are dominating our news. It's difficult to keep up with the rapidity of the news, hour by hour, a press conference in Berlin, statements in Brussels. We follow the news almost hour by hour. With all of this interest, we need clear, calm, and sober analysis of the problems and the possible solutions. And our speakers tonight are very well able to provide such a guide for us. Yannos Alogoskoufis and Yannos Papantoniou, between them, have dominated economic policy making in Greece since the middle of the 1990s. Yannos Papantoniou was Minister of National Economy in the PASOK government from 1994 to 2003. He was 2001. So, yes, I'm rewriting democratic history. a wave of the hand. He was the chief architect of Greece's entry into the euro, and he oversaw Greece's accommodation to the new currency. Dr. Papantoniou holds a PhD in economics from Cambridge University and has served as an economist at the OECD in Paris. Yannos Alogoskoufis was Minister of Economy and Finance from 2004 to January of last year. And becoming minister, he introduced an audit of the state finances and managed Greece through the excessive deficit procedure of the euro system. He himself is a professor of economics at the Athens University of Economics and Business, and he has written widely cited articles in a range of international academic journals. But as we all recognize, this crisis is no longer simply a Greek issue. So we're delighted to welcome two further speakers. How could we talk about the future of the euro without having a German perspective? Can I just move on quickly before you react any further to that comment? Wim Koesters is a noted specialist on the euro and the future of EMU. A few years ago, he co-authored a paper for the European Central Bank arguing that lax monetary policies are no way to bring about structural reforms. Perhaps he thinks there are lessons here for Greece. He is professor of economics at the Ruhr University in Bochum and a member of the Institute for Economic Research in Essen. I won't give it the full title because, forgive me, Wim, the title of the Institute sounds as long as an academic publication in itself. Simon Tilford is chief economist at the Centre for European Reform here in London. He writes extensively on the European Union's economic performance. In a recent paper, he commented that when the southern European states joined the euro, they don't seem to have understood that they were committing themselves to pursuing liberal economic policies. Greece got it wrong. But in good British divide and rule tactics, he also said that German policy was unhelpful in the Eurozone as well. with this cast, we should have an interesting and informed debate representing diverse opinions. I've asked each of our speakers to speak for 10, 12 minutes maximum, and I'm going to have to be quite strict about the time limit. Privately, they've already agreed to be disciplined in their timing, so you can see whether they uphold that. On this basis, there should be plenty of time for questions from you, the audience, and we look forward to that discussion. Can I remind you, in the discussion, of course, that this is a highly topical agenda, hot issues. It's not a political setting. This is a setting for informed academic debates. We're respecting each other's opinion. We're giving time for people to give their opinions. So we will abide by the best traditions of the LSE, and we will respect each other's opinions. So the order we have agreed for the initial presentations for this evening is for Yannos Papantoniou to begin, followed by Wim Koesters, followed by Simon Tilford, and then finally Yorgos Alogoskoufis. So without further ado from me, can I ask you please to give a warm welcome to our panel. I'm going to ask each of our speakers to use the other lectern for the presentation. So, Dr. Papantoniou, would you like to present from here?
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, let me first thank our friend Kevin for taking this initiative and giving us the opportunity to talk about Greece and the euro crisis in a particular topical topic here in London and in Europe. In fact, this is the largest audience I ever spoke to in the LSE, which I think suggests how great the interest is for what we're talking about. I will have to give you a summary of my speech on account of the time limit. And so I will not actually even try to read it. Let me start with some piece of recent Greek economic history to place the present Greek crisis into perspective. If we divide the post-dictatorship period, that is from the beginning of the 70s to the present, the 35 years of so-called metapolitics in Greece, we can divide it into two periods. The first two decades, from the mid-70s to the mid-90s, were years of very weak economic performance. Greece had very large fiscal deficits, more than 15% of GDP, very high inflation, close to 20%, very unstable currency, and low growth, 1.5% on average in the 20 years from 74 to 94. Things changed when Greece tried to enter the Eurozone, and this created new conditions, both as regards stability and growth. Inflation, deficits fell, interest rates fell, the deficit fell from 12 to 3%. Inflation collapsed from 14 to 2%. Growth resumed and reached 4%. And in fact, for 11 consecutive years, that is from 97 to 2008, Greece had the second highest rate of economic growth in the Eurozone. So by most accounts, was a reasonably stable and successful economy. Now, the growth that resulted from the euro accession was essentially a demand phenomenon. Confidence increased the spending by both investors and consumers. There has been a very substantial growth of demand, also helped by the lower interest rates. And fortunately, supply, the production side, responded positively on account of two factors. The first factor was that there have been substantial structural reforms in that period, privatization, multi-liberalization, and so on. And also there has been a substantial modernization of infrastructure, roads, motorways, ports, networks, and so on, thanks partly also to the inflow of community funds. Things started to change, unfortunately, after Greece joined into the Eurozone. There has been a reform fatigue, so to speak. The first sign of that fatigue was the defeat of the socialist government, of Tsimikas' government, on the social security front in 2001. The Tsimikas government had proposed a very radical plan. It was rejected by trade unions. The government succumbed, and this was, in fact, the beginning of the end of the second Tsimikas administration. These things got even worse in the following 5 or 6 years, when clientelism, inaction, laxity became, unfortunately, the dominant features of governance. Competitiveness weakened, the fiscal deficit remained very large, and, in fact, in 2008 and 2009, things exploded. The fiscal deficit got into the range of 13% of GDP, and the public debt took on an explosive trend. This has led to a very substantial rise in interest rates. As we know, the spreads over the German rates have increased very substantially in the last few months, and Greece faces this acute fiscal crisis, which makes it a very vulnerable target for speculators and international investors, which is reinforced by the fact that Greece belongs to the Eurozone. Now, so far as the government is concerned, I think it has taken a number of courageous measures on the fiscal front. It has cut public sector wages, it has increased taxation, it is fighting tax evasion, and is trying to streamline public administration and cut down waste. Also on the structural front, it is starting to face the causes of this weak competitiveness, and the causes basically is excessive statism. I have said on some other occasion that Greece is the last Soviet economy in Europe, because if you count the amount of state intervention the Greek economy suffers, despite the various rounds of market liberalization in the last 20 years, you will still see that the state is too big a thing in the economy. So if we want to reignite growth, I think privatizations, abolishing closed professions, abolishing barriers to competition, removing obstacles to entrepreneurship, are key factors so as to engineer a revival of private investment. However, despite these efforts, the markets continued to doubt Greece's ability to surmount the fiscal problems and set the economy back to a course of sustained growth. And the reason is why. This touches upon the weaknesses of the Eurozone. Greece is not an independent economy. It is a Eurozone member. We hold the euro along with other 15 countries. So this crisis highlighted various weaknesses that are inherent in the functioning of the Eurozone. In a typical monetary union, you have three pillars: the monetary pillar, the fiscal pillar, and the financial pillar. In the Eurozone, you have only one fully constituted pillar, which is the monetary pillar, the European Central Bank. So far as the fiscal policy is concerned, you do have 16 different authorities, and the same holds for the supervision of the financial system. So you have fiscal disunion, you have financial also disunion, and you only have one pillar, which is the euro, supported by the European Central Bank. This makes the Eurozone very different from, say, the US system. You have seen that policy failures are not only typical for a European country. California was a policy failure some years ago in the United States. However, California's fiscal crisis did not undermine the dollar, because in the federal system you have mechanisms of solidarity and sanctions which are there to either prevent or manage default and thus ensure financial stability. The absence of such mechanisms within the Eurozone, underlined by the no bailout clause of the treaty, makes the euro, as well as the sovereign debts of its constituent parts, inviting targets for speculative attacks. Markets take bets on the endurance of the system. And this is exactly what is happening now. And if Greece falls, along the lines of Lehman Brothers' bankruptcy in the beginning of the global financial crisis, bloodthirsty investors will fall on the next victim, which might be Portugal, Ireland, Spain, and why not even Italy. So the rise in Greek borrowing costs owe to two factors. The first factor are Greece's own problems of its own making, and the second factor is the weaknesses which markets have spotted in the structure of the Eurozone and the exploitation of these weaknesses for speculative purposes. The absence of mechanisms of bailout makes no sense, because it is not reasonable to expect that in a union of 16 countries or the union of 50 states, and as in America, which is bound to live for decades, if not centuries, not a single country, not a single state will ever display irresponsible behavior and ask for assistance. Just assume that this won't ever happen, and this is the hidden assumption behind the no bailout clause, is not a clever assumption to make, and this is a basic defect in the very construction of the Eurozone. Now, for the time being, to address the Greek problem, an ad hoc mechanism of financial assistance has been devised, as you know, which consists of the IMF assistance plus bilateral Eurozone loans, coordinated by the ECB and the European Commission. Greece has requested the activation of this mechanism, and negotiations have already started, and Mrs. Merkel and Mr. Strauss-Kahn and Jean-Claude Trichet in Berlin have confirmed that the negotiations are about to be concluded very soon. However, this does not resolve the problem. If the euro is to survive for a long period of time, as the dollar has survived for, I don't know, two centuries, longer-term arrangements aiming at improving economic governance must be set. And what type of arrangements are these? Two things are necessary: to create or recreate the fiscal pillar, and to unify financial supervision. Now, on the fiscal pillar, the aim would be as follows. We should reinforce the fiscal authority of the Eurogroup so as to ensure discipline by designing very harsh sanctions, because apparently the Stability and Security Pact did not work, partially because Germany violated the pact as a result of the German unification for 4 years and did not get punished, because it was a very big and heavy country. So we have to devise heavier sanctions and penalties for deviations, but also we should move towards common budget policies. And what I mean by this: you cannot have countries like Germany with a consistent structural external surplus, because this external surplus is mirrored in other countries' deficits, and other countries' external deficits impose to them deflationary policies. So you must have a more intelligent way to distribute domestic demand. So you must have a common plan for budget policies throughout the Eurozone. I know, of course, that Germany and other countries do not wish to relinquish this type of fiscal authority to the European Commission or the Eurogroup, but this must be done if we have to have a consistent and coherent fiscal policy for the entire Eurozone. The second thing is the bailout mechanism. Now, there are many ways to approach it. The simpler way would be to issue Eurobonds, but of course there is a question of compensating Germany for lending its credibility to Spain, to Greece, to other weaker countries to borrow at heavier rates, but a compensation mechanism could be devised. And of course a more radical solution would be the creation of a European Monetary Fund along the lines of the IMF, which would ensure this combination of solidarity with sanctions, which would allow the Eurozone to address policy failures which are inherent in any market system. You cannot imagine that the market system works and survives without ever encountering the problem of a policy failure. It is part of our life, it is part of our logic. Yes, I finish. Actually, you interrupted at the very end of my speech. to conclude. to conclude, what is the lessons of the crisis, of the Greek euro crisis? First of all, so far as the facing the crisis, two things are essential. The first thing is that Greece must get its act together and promote at very fast speed, with great effectiveness, the major fiscal and structural reforms which are necessary to achieve fiscal consolidation and a substantial improvement in our competitiveness, so as to convince the markets that we are creditworthy to go back to them and borrow at reasonable rates. And then the Eurozone must get its act together very quickly, both in the short term by announcing at the latest on Sunday the activation of the mechanism for financial assistance, although the short-term mechanism of financial assistance, but also starting a serious discussion for devising the longer-term arrangements for transforming the existing monetary union into a fully-fledged economic and political union by supplementing with fiscal and other powers so as to give the euro to the chance to survive. I believe that these are very important steps to be taken, both to avoid a Greek disaster, but also to ensure the long-term sustainability and viability of the euro. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin, for inviting me to this debate. It's quite an honor to speak in front of such a big audience and I think also a distinguished audience. When I listened to the declaration of the Greek Prime Minister last week, it came to my mind that I could start like this. Andra moene permusa polytroponos valapola. That's the beginning of the Odyssey by Homer. And maybe the Musa could inspire us to find ways to make the period of wandering shorter than it used to be in the past 10 years. And maybe we can make it shorter this time. But therefore, we should know the way to Ithaca, where Penelope and the son of Odysseus, Telemachos, was waiting. So I want to organize my lecture in that way that I first want to say a few words to Germany and German concerns, and then to the nature of the crisis and the causes of the crisis, and finally to the future of the Eurozone. One can understand the German position only if one realizes that in the last century we had two big inflations after the two world wars, which were financed by printing money. And so within one generation, Germans lost nearly all their financial savings. And that created a high aversion against inflation in Germany. And the low inflation rates were due to the monetary constitution created after the war, and the stable Deutschmark was the result of this aversion and of the constitution, the monetary constitution we created in Germany. And when we had to give up the Deutschmark, it was very difficult for the Germans to give it up because it was a stable currency and it was a symbol for the recovery of Germany after the war. And so the Germans hoped and were assured by the politicians that the euro will become as stable as the Deutschmark was before. And all the institutions created should care for that. Now, if the euro will become unstable, Germans will have problems. And they also will have problems if the rules agreed upon will be broken by some countries and the Germans have to pay for it. So that is considered not to be fair. The present Greek crisis, let me come to the nature of the crisis. Let me add, at the moment we have a regional election in Northern Rhine-Westphalia.
And,
And therefore, the politicians are also quite nervous, and some reactions can be explained by that. The nature of the crisis, the present Greek crisis is not only a fiscal crisis. You know, all know that the debt quota and the deficit quota are the highest in Europe. I can skip that. Also, the interest rates Greece has to pay for its sovereign debt are highest in Europe. But it's important to notice that Greece also has a problem of international competitiveness. The Greek wages increased, the Greek current account deficits increased from 7 to 14% after joining the euro. Now it's around 10%. And that's also due, not only due to the huge increase, that's the current account deficits here, and now the wages, yeah. The wages were increasing in Greece much more than, for instance, in Germany. And if you have fixed nominal exchange rates, then that will mean a revaluation of the Greek euro, and that makes them not competitive anymore. Let me come to the causes of the crisis. Of course, one has to say that Greece didn't take serious its membership in the European Monetary Union. It forged the budget figures in order to be admitted in 2001, and in the following years, it again forged the deficit figures and reported wrong figures to Brussels. And that created uncertainty, and that created also mistrust against the figures, and they deceived themselves even, because they don't know in what economic situation they are now exactly. And of course, also the world doesn't know, and the rest of the world doesn't know. Greece enjoyed first the benefits of the euro in that the interest rates came down, and so the government debt could be financed more easily. But these funds were not used to make Greece competitive and to reform the economic structure. As it seems, really, to me, Greek politicians did not understand that EMU membership means significantly more systems competition. And that makes a policy adjustment necessary. We created in the European Monetary Union a system of super globalization, I call that. We have more systems competition than in the rest of the world. And that was not taken care of. But not Greece alone caused the crisis. There were also some others around. The European Commission did not demand strict keeping of the convergence criteria and the rules of the Stability and Growth Pact. Already in the first round, they didn't have a close look to it, and so Italy and Belgium were admitted, although they didn't fulfill the criteria. Germany was admitted, although Germany didn't fulfill the debt criterion, because Germany had only slightly above 60% debt quota, but the debt quota was increasing because of the German reunification. But an increasing debt quota cannot be accepted by the treaty, so Germany should have not been admitted to the Monetary Union. Then in 2002, 1 year after the admission of Greece to the Monetary Union, Romano Prodi, the then president of the European Commission, said the Stability and Growth Pact is stupid. Like, all rigid rules are stupid. Yeah, if the president of the Commission says that, who really can expect that there will be a strict monitoring of the rules of the Commission? Then it was mentioned Germany violated the deficit criterion in 2003, and the Schröder government reacted the critique. And together with France, they diluted the rules of the Stability and Growth Pact. And in the last election campaign in France, all candidates were demanding a change of the rules of the European Monetary Union. So the rules of the Monetary Union were not accepted. These are the... Oh, I already... Oh. So now it shows up, this bad governance shows up, and the future of the Eurozone is very uncertain, in my view, because Europe was unable to manage the European Monetary Union. Now it has to call the IMF, and financial assistance to Greece means that the no bailout clause has to be broken. So that causes credibility problems, moral hazard problems, and we pay a high price for that because the financial assistance will help Greece only shortly. Now estimates go around that Greece needs 70, 90 or even more billions of euro. And that could only help for a short period of time. So does Greece have to devalue? Does Greece have to leave the European Monetary Union is the question. Or do the financial markets force Greece out of the Monetary Union? That's also a possibility. So we need to go back to the rules we made up. We have to make them credible again. That's the only way, because Europe should become international more competitive. And if we change the rules in that way, as some propose, then these rules will not make Europe more competitive. The only way to do it is back to the rules, back to credible and respected rules, which are respected really by all the countries. So, then I close. Thank you.
Simon Tilford.
Good evening. I feel like a giant up here. First, thank you very much to Kevin for inviting me here this evening. I feel flattered to be in such company. I only wish I could be more upbeat in what I'm going to say. The first half of the question was, can Greece correct its financial position and undertake the necessary reforms for future prosperity? Well, to make Greece's financial position sustainable will require an enormous adjustment, something in the order of 10 to 12 percentage points of GDP in 2, maybe 3 years. And this without a devaluation, which would typically accompany a consolidation of this size in a country with a current account deficit as big as Greece's. So what we're looking at is quite unprecedented. Investors believe the country can't pull it off, and their scepticism is understandable. First, the starting point is very, very bad. The overall level of debt is high and increasing very, very rapidly. The deficit is huge, and the country's debt maturity structure is very, very unfavourable. Second, and crucially, Greece's growth prospects, economic growth prospects, are very poor. The country's financial position will not be sustainable against a backdrop of slump and deflation. However much the Greek authorities cut public spending by, you cannot put a country's public finances on a sustainable footing if the economy is slumping or contracting more quickly than you can cut public spending. But slump is precisely where Greece is heading. The economy this year will probably contract by about 5%. Prospects for next year, pretty grim, probably stagnation, no growth at best. What Greece needs is a huge positive external stimulus to offset the cuts in public spending and falls in real wages. In short, exports need to grow much more rapidly than imports over an extended period of time. Now, how likely is this to happen? Well, not very, I'm afraid, because import demand, of course, will be very weak because of the collapse in domestic demand, but Greece also needs much, much stronger exports. Unfortunately, exports only account for about 20% of Greek GDP. So the percentage increase in exports will need to be very, very big. In the absence of devaluation, Greece is dependent on a revival of demand elsewhere in the Eurozone and the ability of Greek companies to become more price competitive relative to their counterparts elsewhere in the Eurozone and hence to take market share within the currency union. Now, the best way of improving price competitiveness is through higher productivity, but that is a long-term challenge. Greece does not have that kind of time. The country has no choice but to try and cut costs relative to the rest of the Eurozone. Now, this is possible. Germany and the Netherlands have successfully pursued eye-watering wage restraint within the Eurozone. The problem, of course, is that it's impossible for all economies to do that simultaneously. It's a zero-sum game. It's one thing for a member state to cut costs relative to the rest of the Eurozone when costs across the Eurozone are rising quite rapidly. It's a whole different ballgame to cut costs relative to the Eurozone when costs across the Eurozone are stagnant or falling, particularly when they're stagnant or falling in Germany, which again is pursuing further wage restraint on top of the last 10 years of wage restraint we've seen in the country. A Greek debt restructuring looks unavoidable. Whatever finally comes through from the EU and the IMF will help a bit, but it's hard to see it being sufficient. I think the question at this point is really about the degree of default, not whether there's going to be one. The second part of the question was, what are the implications for the governance of the Eurozone and the future performance of the euro? It's worth remembering that Greece is just the starkest example of the challenges facing a number of Eurozone economies, with big external deficits, weak public finances, and very poor growth prospects. The failure to contain the crisis, the Greek crisis, means we're already seeing contagion to some of these. We're already seeing contagion to Portugal. There are other vulnerable economies. Greece is the big, Spain is the big worry because of its size, clearly. To believe that making an example of Greece will force others to put their houses in order and secure the stability of the Eurozone is simplistic. It ignores the fact that Greece's problems and those of the other struggling member states cannot be solved by them alone. Indeed, the EU strategy so far appears to have been tailor-made to ensure precisely the kind of contagion that they profess to want to avoid. I see three things need to happen to ensure long-term stability of the Eurozone. The first, southern member states absolutely must get serious about reform. Their elites have tended to treat the euro as a shield from the outside world, but membership is also a corset. It requires economies to have flexible markets for goods, services, and labour. That's not an option. It's a prerequisite for success in the currency union. Devaluation is not an option, so their economies have to become more productive and flexible. Unfortunately, they've shown very little appetite. This is not just Greece. It's economies across the south who are forming highly regulated labour markets for opening up more sectors to competition, etc., etc. They have to be honest about what they've signed up for, and so far they haven't been. Two, the surplus member states need to strengthen domestic demand. The German government is right to call for reform across southern Europe, but weak domestic demand in Germany also threatens the sustainability of the Eurozone. If the Eurozone economies with large external surpluses such as Germany will not or cannot rebalance their economies, the struggling southern member states will find it very difficult to extract themselves from this mess, almost irrespective of what they do. Their fiscal policies, for example, will not improve if their economies contract faster than they can cut public spending, as I mentioned earlier. The result would be ongoing slump and fiscal crisis. Indeed, if Germany's economic model, which relies on enormous wage restraint and the running of huge external surpluses, was exported to the rest of the Eurozone, the result would be beggar thy neighbour wage cuts and perpetual slump and stagnation in Europe, and we would have fiscal problems everywhere, not just in Greece, Spain, Portugal, Italy, etc. Third and finally, there needs to be greater institutional integration. The crisis has, I think, exposed the fallacy of believing it's possible to have a host of largely sovereign economies sharing a currency. This really is, currency in search of a market to a large extent. There needs to be much greater policy coordination and mutual oversight. In short, a progressive move to economic government within the Eurozone. Unfortunately, there is no agreement amongst the member states on what such economic government would entail. Eurozone finance ministers did issue a statement in March saying that imbalances within the Eurozone could only be addressed by action on the part of both deficit and surplus countries. But various governments, not least the German one, have made it abundantly clear that the only binding mechanism they will accept will be one to enforce stricter budget discipline. But you can't have Eurozone stability without growth. Budgetary discipline itself is not going to provide a sustainable, is not going to ensure the sustainability of the euro.
1 minute.
1 minute. And there's certainly no chance of any kind of move to a fiscal union. We heard about the third pillar, fiscal pillar. I think we're highly unlikely to see that. I think we need to, in the absence of the imbalances being addressed or unwound, some kind of fiscal union would appear to be a prerequisite for the survival of the Eurozone in its current form. If those imbalances are not unwound, and there is no move to some element, at least, of fiscal supranationalism, then I think we will see ongoing crises and some probably managed dismantling of the Eurozone as we know it in its current form. Thank you.
George Alogoskoufis.
Let me also thank Kevin for organizing this very interesting session and the LSE for hosting us. I have a very long speech, which of course I will not deliver. It will be available, I guess, on your website for people who want to look at it. I will concentrate on a number on two issues, really. On one is the issue of whether the Eurozone can coordinate its policy responses to the current crisis. And the second issue, of course, is where the Greek problem that is at the center of attention right now. When the crisis, the second part of the crisis erupted in, at the end of, I will not use the presentation. When the second part of the crisis erupted in September 2008, I was still a member of the Eurogroup, and I remember that the coordination of the European responses at the time was both quick and relatively effective to the initial the initial effects of the crisis. The presidency of Sarkozy in France made for a very active coordination and a very active response to the crisis. Discussions since then have essentially focused on how we apply the Stability and Growth Pact. You may recall that the Stability and Growth Pact was revised in 2008 to allow it to be more flexible than originally. And it was decided since late 2008 to apply the pact relatively flexibly to allow countries to exceed temporarily the 3% limit. Of course, since then, in 2009, we have seen that the European economy has entered into a recession, a very deep recession. Fiscal deficits have increased everywhere, not just in Greece, because people tend to forget that there are many other euro area economies, many other economies, including the economy that is hosting us tonight, that have very high deficits. There is now a discussion going on how we shall manage to go back to fiscal consolidation, both in the Eurozone and outside the Eurozone, without responses that will stifle the recovery. And these are the issues that concern us apart from Greece. Of course, small peripheral economies like Greece, Portugal, Ireland, and larger economies like Spain have been experiencing more serious fiscal problems and the widening of their government bond yields relative to the German benchmark. And these economies, which we have to admit that were among the main beneficiaries of the creation of the euro, had until 2007 growth rates that were much higher than average. All of those economies had much higher growth rates than average. However, they had also seen their current accounts, account deficits rise considerably. And this was partly the result of autonomous capital inflows that were entering those economies when the risk of devaluation disappeared after the creation of the euro. Now, let me say a few things now about Greece, which is probably the most difficult case. Since the elections of 2009, the Greek economy has been at the center of international attention. The focus has been on the fiscal situation, which worsened since the crisis, not unlike in many other economies in the euro area and the rest of the world. Because we have to keep in mind that the worsening of the fiscal situation in Greece is not so much different from what happened in other economies as well. Now, if one were to look at the fundamentals of the Greek economy, one would note that in the 20 years which it took to prepare for the euro and since euro membership, the fundamentals have improved significantly. Unemployment fell, the growth was quite high. Of course, inflation went very near to the euro area average. So the fundamentals improved both in the run-up to the euro, and especially after the creation of the euro. The one exception has been public finances, and the second exception has been international competitiveness. With the public finances have remained a problem throughout the period, and the international competitiveness has kept deteriorating because of higher inflation and higher wage growth in Greece relative to the rest of the eurozone. There were short periods of improvement. The few years before we entered the euro, there was an improvement in the fiscal situation. The few years after 2004, when I was the finance minister, we tried to reduce the deficit, and we reduced it substantially by 2006. But these periods were the exception. And then elections came, and the usual relapse took place in Greece. So the international financial crisis in 2008 hit the Greek economy at its Achilles heel. The high public debt, which was accumulated in mainly during the 1980s. Since the 1980s, from the early 1990s onwards, the debt was stabilized as a percent of GDP. It was stabilized at about 100% of GDP for almost 20 years. There were periods that it was going a little down, and periods that it was going up a little bit, but it was stabilized roughly around 100% of GDP. And Greece had no problem financing this debt for about 20 years. It was financing it at market interest rates with very low spreads over the German bonds. The problem became serious because of the international financial crisis. And it became much more serious after the elections of October 2009, when Greece found itself in the center of a wave of criticism by the international press, international organizations, rating agencies, the European Commission. Why did this happen? Because despite the fact that the fiscal situation in Greece in 2009 worsened not much more than in other Eurozone economies, Greece became the focus of attention. I think that this happened for three reasons. The first and foremost is the high level of debt, which Greece had stabilized at 100% of GDP, but 100% of GDP is a very high level of debt. So compared to other Eurozone economies, Greece had a much higher debt compared to its deficits. The second, of course, was the sudden announcement of the dramatic deterioration of the deficit in 2009 by the new government in October 2009. This took markets by surprise, as the previous administration insisted that it would achieve a much lower deficit. And the third reason is related to the delay of the new administration to tackle the fiscal situation and, of course, the shortcomings of the program that was announced. So there were at least three reasons that Greece found itself at the center of attention. And it is these three reasons that created the circumstances for a sustained speculative attack on Greek bonds, which has led to the severe confidence crisis that exists today. Now, under these circumstances, the Greek government has no other option than to accelerate the implementation of structural reforms, which under different circumstances could be implemented more gradually. Greece now has no other option but to follow a particularly drastic program of fiscal adjustment and structural reforms. Ideally, it should aim for fiscal consolidation and an improvement in competitiveness that would help the recovery, but it's very difficult to see what measures would help the recovery of the Greek economy. We should aim to reduce fiscal deficits below the average of the euro area in 3 years at the latest, and we should further aim to stabilize public debt as a percent of GDP by, in my opinion, by 2011 at the latest. We should not allow public debt to keep rising as a percent of GDP. We should stabilize it by 2011 to drastically reduce the debt-to-GDP ratio in the ensuing decade. Between, say, 2011 and 2020, we should have a very firm target to reduce the debt as a percent of GDP, much below 100% where it was stabilized before. And only a fully credible fiscal program will convince markets, rating agencies, and Greece's EU partners. Now, this is easy to say. It's much more difficult to implement. And especially in current market conditions where Greece is essentially locked out of the international bond markets. So in the meantime, it is imperative that Greece should make use of the European support mechanism that is being created right now, and in the next few days, I think, will be fully announced, in order to have some breathing space until the program starts bearing fruit. Because the program will not have effects immediately, it will have effects after a few months. Greece needs a breathing space, and the European support mechanism should be used as a breathing space in that period. With concrete evidence of substantial fiscal improvement, it will be very difficult, without concrete evidence of substantial fiscal improvement, it will be very difficult for Greece to return to financial markets. And although it is imperative that Greece should aim to return to financial markets as soon as possible, we cannot allow ourselves to be excluded from financial markets because there is this European support mechanism. We should only use it in the short term as a breathing space to give us some time to implement the program, to see some results, and then we should try to go back to international financial markets. Of course, yes, okay. Greece will succeed, of course, if the rest of the euro area has a successful and coordinated response. And I will say in 1 minute the five main elements of what I mean by a successful response of the euro area. First of all, we all realize that in all of the euro area there needs to be fiscal adjustment. But we have to distinguish between the fiscal adjustment of the countries that have low deficits and are big countries, the engines of growth in the euro area, and the smaller peripheral economies which have the biggest problems. The bigger economies without serious fiscal problems should go for a very gradual fiscal adjustment in order not to stifle the recovery. Whereas the smaller economies should have a program very much like Greece's, a very drastic program of reducing fiscal deficits. The ECB should continue to provide adequate liquidity as it has been doing, until we are certain that the recovery is firm and in place. The contingency plans that have been created for Greece must be available to other euro area members that may or may not need them. And despite its shortcomings, we should accelerate structural reforms that improve European competitiveness. Thank you very much.
Can I thank each of our speakers for their presentations, but also for their discipline? It allows us time for the questions and answers. As you can see in the hall, there are colleagues with the red t-shirts and microphones. So I'm going to suggest, if the panel will agree, that we collect perhaps three questions and then come back to the panel and invite any of you to respond to those questions. So we'll try to group the questions. Could you please make sure that it is a question rather than a speech? Could you please identify yourself? And could you please indicate those who would wish to take a question now? We'll take the gentleman here.
I'm going to start with a tactless question, and after that it can only get better. The tactless question is, would a measure of default in the Greek national debt be consistent with Greece remaining in the European Union? In the Eurozone.
Thank you. Did you get the question? It's very pleased, Sam Britton, one of our most established, respected financial journalists.
Not after the
and the gentleman here. The gentleman here.
Raphael Papadopoulos. I am an emeritus professor of thermodynamics. I have a problem.
There's enough heat in the question.
Sorry?
There's enough heat in the debate already.
I have a question for Professor Koesters. He said that the markets may force Greece out of the monetary union. Now, the question is simple. Should the Eurogroup allow this to happen in view of the consequences. And if the international speculators, I basically agree with your analysis about the problem, and the problem is a problem of credibility, not only of observing or violating the rules. But if that happens, what happens next? Which country comes after Greece? Well,
okay.
That is something which the European Union has to think very carefully about.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? There's the gentleman right at the very back in the red. I'm sorry, there seems to be one person who's running with the microphone.
Hi, I'm a student here in the MS Economics at the LSE. So I have a question. We hear quite often that the Greek figures for inflation or deficit are revised with an upward trend. How has this been possible, and what's wrong with national statistics in Greece?
Could we perhaps go in the reverse order of the speakers? I mean nothing by that.
Okay.
It should be okay.
Does this work? Okay. The question on restructuring. I think that Greece should do everything in its power, and the euro area should do everything in its power to avoid even talk about restructuring. As I said, it is very, very important that there is an improvement in the fundamentals, in the fiscal position. Of course, this cannot take place overnight. It will need a few years to take effect. It is very, very important that Greece returns to the markets as soon as the markets calm down, because they're clearly now in the current situation, Greece cannot next month, say, go back to the markets, but it could go back to the markets in 6 months or even in a year at the latest, and avoid any discussion, any hint that it is thinking about restructuring, because restructuring will be very bad for Greece. Now, does restructuring mean that if it were to happen that you go out of the Eurozone? I think we are in uncharted territories, uncharted territory here. There are no rules that deal with the restructuring of the debt, but it's very, very important that we keep an orderly market for Greek bonds.
Okay.
Or we go back to an orderly market for Greek bonds. Now, the problem with the national statistics. The problem with national statistics exists. It is not a question, I don't think that any Greek government ever on purpose tried to mislead anybody with statistics. As a minister in 2004, I asked for an audit by the European Commission, the European Statistical Authority, the Eurostat, to do an audit on Greek national accounts. It is true that there were misreportings and there were many weaknesses that Eurostat was highlighting for a number of years, and there was a big revision in national statistics. What also came out of this is that there are some structural problems in the collection of Greek national statistics, not so much to do with the central government, but with various public authorities. Essentially, the problems are concentrated in three areas. One is local authorities, which do not have full accounts and do not provide timely accounts. The second is social security funds, which again do not have full accounts and do not provide accounts that are credible in a timely manner. And the third is hospitals, the hospital sector, the health sector. There have been improvements in the last few years, but again, problems remain. In 2008, we had a legislation that forced all those organizations, all those sectors, to submit full budgets and full accounts. Unfortunately, because of the weaknesses of those organizations, this has not been possible even today. Even today, we do not have timely accounts for large parts of the public sector, which are hospitals, social security funds, and local authorities. I think that the new government will make it a priority to continue with the improvement that we have had. And it is very, very important, both for the markets and for Greece's participation in the Eurozone, to have as credible public accounts as we can.
Can we just pause? I'm sure some in the audience would like me to just follow up with one question so that we can clear up this matter. Of course, days before the last election, Greece was reporting to Brussels that the deficit was less than 6%. Days after the election, the governor of the Bank of Greece was saying that it's probably 10%, possibly up to 13% by December. How is that possible?
Well, this, I think it's a good question. And let me clear that I was not the minister. but anyway, what happened in 2009 was that the outgoing administration kept insisting that it would keep the deficit at around 6% because it had plans to be implemented partly after the election to reduce the deficit. But this was not false reporting, it was a false forecast, if you like. It was not that data was sent to the European Commission that said that, you know, this is our data. This was a forecast about what would happen in 2009. The new government came up with a different forecast and with a different policy. And as I said in my speech originally, this was one of the reasons that Greece is facing the difficult problems today.
Okay, thanks, Simon.
I'll start on the third point first, Greek data. Clearly, repeated increases in the estimated size of the deficit have done a lot to unsettle investor confidence in Greece and in the ability of the country's government to actually manage the situation. It has been hugely damaging, quite corrosive, in fact. On the first point, is restructuring or even default consistent with continued membership of the Eurozone? I think it is. It's uncharted territory, as has been pointed out. But now that investors are fully distinguishing between the sovereign debts of the various member states and attaching the relevant risk premia to their respective debts, it's not as if a member state can run up dramatic debts at German interest rates, default, and then start over all over again. I think it's possible to imagine them defaulting and remaining in the Eurozone, yes. Although it's clearly uncharted territory, there'll be a lot of opposition to them being allowed to do that. Thirdly, should we allow markets to force Greece out of the Euro? What can we do to prevent it? I think it's worth remembering that markets have not created this problem. They've been managed very, very, very poorly, particularly since the beginning of the year. I think the Eurozone or the EU has grossly underestimated the power of the markets and the credibility deficit that we see vis-a-vis Greece and a number of other Eurozone member states. We're only going to address the problem if we take steps to address that underlying credibility deficit. Blaming the markets for it, I think, won't wash.
Thanks. Wim?
First question. We have an unprecedented situation at the moment. We don't have an example of that the member of a monetary union would be in danger to go bankrupt or to default. I don't know how we should manage that and what would come out if we would have a default of Greece or of another EMU member country. So we then have to manage that and not try to manage the situation. Then the second question, if there would be only pure speculation, then that could be brought down by intervention or so. But if it has a reason, it was already emphasized before, if it has a reason, then the markets can be successful in forcing Greece out. Mistrust was there, and so it can happen, really. The last question I asked myself, too, how can it happen that these figures were wrong reported? The European Commission should have been warned, because before the start of the monetary union, there was a lot of creative bookkeeping, it was called, going around, and Germany was also trying to do this, and that was stopped or not stopped, I don't know, so maybe some were successful and it was not discovered. But so the European Commission should have been warned and should have looked closer to these problems in the case of Greece, Italy, and other countries.
Thanks.
I will try to answer two questions. The first concerns the statistics, and the second is the question of default and continued EU membership. Now, concerning the statistics, there are two issues here. The first issue is whether Greece, as Professor Koesters said, repeating what some German politicians say during the election period, Greece fudged the numbers. Now, what are the figures? What are the actual facts? When Greece joined the euro, it reported the following figures: that in 93 the deficit was 12% of GDP, and in 99, which was the year of evaluation, the deficit was 2% of GDP. Then, years afterwards, in 2004, a revision has been made, which revised the figures throughout the period, including not only a revision of the figures, also a change of the rules in accounting for defense expenditure. It emerged that in the year 99, the new figure for the deficit was 3.1%. So the conclusion is that Greece's fiscal adjustment was not 10 percentage points of GDP in the course of 5 years, as we had suggested, but only 9%. I ask, which other Eurozone country has achieved such a huge fiscal adjustment in such a short period of time? The second thing is that being in excess of the Maastricht criterion by 0.1% is a ridiculous reason to claim that you fudged the figures, for two reasons. The first reason is that if the rules for defense accounting were not changed, Greece still would be well below the 3% in 1999. And the second reason is that many Eurozone countries have revised their deficit figures, and it emerged that in the year of evaluation they were well above 3%. For instance, France, in the year of evaluation, after revising the figures, had a deficit of 3.5% of GDP, not 3.1%. And Belgium, the same, and I think a third country as well. Did anybody suggest from Germany that France fudged its way into the Eurozone? So this is a big lie. I think I have said so in many interviews, both in CNN and elsewhere. The truth of the matter is, first, that without a change of the rules, Greece will be well below 3%. The second thing is that the effort undertaken by the government and the Greek people for fiscal adjustment in that period was huge and enormously successful. And the third point is that people should be more careful for using these words, and I've been extremely astonished that Professor Koesters dared to use this word without actually being sure what he's talking about. Now, concerning now the general question of data. Concerning the general question of data. Definitely the data are weak in Greece. They're weak for two reasons. The first reason is the overall inefficiency of our administrative mechanism, which also affects the statistical service, which is not competent enough to collect data on a reliable basis from the wider public sector, being local administration or social security agencies or whatever. And the second thing is, which is truly unacceptable, is that the statistical agency is not an independent institution as in most countries, it is a branch of government. So it is open to political pressure, not for falsifying, of course, the figures. This is, again, a very stupid remark to make, but for manipulating the time of the delivery. That is, if there is an election, the minister is in a position to instruct the head of the statistical service to delay the publication of a bad inflation figure, of a bad deficit figure, so as not to worsen the prospects of his government winning the election. This is exactly what happened in 2009. I close this unhappy chapter, but I ask for everybody, including Professor Koesters, to be extremely much more careful when using words which have an offensive character and falsify the truth. Now, concerning the other...
Sorry.
We have heard enough from Germans, so I'm allowed to make this point.
Could we ask you...
But frankly, sorry. Enough is enough.
Could we just ask you to pause there? You'll have plenty of time to come back with...
No, let me ask for the answer for the default.
Two sentences.
Absolutely, yes. No. Not two sentences, because this also concerns Germany. What is the question? What is the relation between default and EU members? First of all, default is a wrong option for Greece for the obvious reason that it will be a stigma in the relations between Greece and the markets, for which Greece will have to pay for many years to come. So it is a very bad option. Secondly, is it consistent with EU membership? Of course, it is uncharted territories, but my impression is that there are people in Germany and forces in Germany which have, for a number of reasons which are obvious, taken a different view as to whether Greece ought or should be a member of the Eurozone. So if Greece defaults, I'm sure that some people in Germany will say this is incompatible with continuing membership because it is not reasonable for two countries to belong to the same monetary family, issue paper on the same currency, and the first country, Greece, to price its paper, say 100, but to be valued 60 after the default, while the other country, Germany, to price its paper 100 and be still 100 in value. So membership of the devalued country devalues the integrity of the common currency. So I think that it is dangerous for Greece to default because this might open a discussion about Greece exiting the Eurozone.
Okay, thanks. So, could we have some more show of questions? Let's go on the other side. There's the gentleman in the blue shirt here.
Hi, my name is Chris Iwano.
Sorry, we can't hear you.
My name is Chris Iwano, and my question goes one layer below the ability to pay. Concerning willingness to pay. The growth that Greece has seen in the last 15 or 20 years has been extremely important. There's been an extreme amount of corruption in the disbursement of funds, and there are a large number of people in Greece who say, why should we pay? We didn't benefit from the money that was borrowed. Why should we pay? So the ability to extract the type of concessions that are needed for the fiscal adjustment isn't the question that was addressed. In your opinions, knowing the structure of Greek society, what is the chance of a nasty surprise?
Thank you. Gentleman in the white shirt here.
Good evening, thank you for coming. My name is Apostolos Pitas and I'm a master's student here in IR. My question is regarding the IMF's role in Greece and in the Eurozone. From all the readings that I have done on the IMF, I see it to be an institution that goes into a country with a loan, with the knowledge that the loan will not be able to be repaid, thus incurring the country even more debt. And that country, in essence, will owe the lender with repayments with either votes in the United Nations or favors or acquisition of natural resources. I was wondering if we are to be cautious of the IMF's presence, which in essence is an American presence in Europe. What are your thoughts on this?
Okay, thanks. And the lady here, please.
Adina Stevis from Eleftheropia newspaper, Athens. I think there is a huge elephant sitting in this room, and I think it's time to respectfully address it. As Kevin rightly pointed out, the two gentlemen sitting at the extremes of the panel have held the fates of the Greek economy in their hands for the best part of the previous decade. So my paper's readers, and I think the Greek citizens, deserve an honest answer. For example, Mr. Papantoniou, what happened in 2001 with the deal that was struck while you were finance minister between the Greek government and Goldman Sachs? Mr. Alogoskoufis. Sorry, I'm not asking this for crowd pleasing. Mr. Alogoskoufis, in the case of your administration, what happened with the statistics that you announced and oversaw? What happened with expenditure? And wherever the deficit and the debt are measured, the reality is that they are large. They are very large. And this money has gone somewhere. And it's money from the Greek taxpayer and the European taxpayer from Brussels and the fund. So what happened? Did politics happen?
Okay, thanks. And the final question in this round to the gentleman here.
Makis Galiatsatos, this question is for Mr. Papantoniou and Mr. Alogoskoufis. Before I start, I put the question forward, I'd like to state my personal opinion. I do strongly believe what the vast majority of the Greek people believe, that all governments after Junta who govern this country share a responsibility for that tragedy, for the today's tragedy. Now the question. In 1922, Greece suffered the so-called the Asia Minor disaster. Six of the responsible people, generals and politics, were executed in Goudi. Unfortunately, after the execution of Nikos Beloyannis in Greece, we have abolished.
No, please. Can we just have a pause here?
Yes.
We cannot, in an academic debate, have suggestions of this kind.
No. There is a.
Wait a minute. The lady over here.
No.
No, please. The lady over here has made a personal attack. We're not here to deal with cheap
Kevin,
remarks.
Kevin, excuse me.
We're not here to deal with cheap remarks. We're here for questions and debate. Can we now go to the panel? I am going to direct, as the lady over here asked, and other questioners have asked, I'm going to ask, firstly, Dr. Papantoniou to answer two questions, and then also Professor Alogoskoufis to answer two questions. For Dr. Papantoniou, there was a question about why should Greeks pay in the context of corruption, etc. Why should it hit the ordinary Greek? There is a question also about Goldman Sachs and 2001. Dr. Papantoniou.
Well, I start with the Goldman Sachs agreement.
Got the microphone, please.
Oh, sorry.
Interest rate swap agreements were made by most European governments at the time. The Greek case was not different from any other swap agreement made by Italy, Belgium, Spain, and any other country. And the reporting of this agreement was fully consistent with the arrangements that were prevalent at the time. The first time the European Commission imposed some limits on the extent to which governments could use the swap agreements was in 2008, that is 7 years after the 2001 agreement. That's why the case was not given any kind of follow-up, and there is no problem whatsoever with this agreement. Now, concerning the evident question that has been put on how to distribute the cost of the adjustment in Greece, I agree that there is a heavy responsibility of a corrupt administration in terms of the fact that a lot of tax evasion in Greece and a lot of waste in government spending owes to a great laxity in the way the state functions. And this laxity owes to a huge bureaucracy, owes to a great party intervention in which has abolished meritocracy in the administration, and also to the fact that the supervisory authorities for corruption work very weakly, and also the fact that justice does not function well in Greece, because, for instance, in many cases, you know that many issues have gone to justice, fully documented, and then somehow, due to statutes of limitations, due to long delays, and look to the inefficiency of the justice system, no punishment is performed. So all this is a part of this unfortunate history. Now, the point is what to do about it. The question is that we have this huge deficit. We have this huge debt. I agree that it is unfair to that the average worker pays for it. And that's why we believe, and the government, the present government believes, that the deficit should not be redressed by either raising taxes or cutting incomes of particularly of the weakest social groups, but by tackling the two major issues which are at the root of the fiscal problem of Greece. The first is tax evasion, and there we need a strong financial police, which unfortunately had been abolished, but now it is being resurrected, and we need a strong system of electronic surveillance of incomes and spending of households, coupled with a very effective system of controls. The present government is doing precisely that. And the other thing is the waste in government spending, which is all these party recruitments, which must be reversed at some point, and of course, putting order in some public corporations, namely railways, where exceptionally high expenditure occurs and is not justified. So the challenge for the present government is to avoid the conventional weapons of tax rises and income cuts, and focus on redressing the basic problems, which is tax evasion and waste, by hitting this monster, which is called the great and inefficient state that has bedeviled Greek politics and economics for so many years. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Professor Alogoskoufis.
One of the issues that have been raised has to do with, you know, who is to blame for Greece being at this position right now. And it is true, and we all have to admit that we are all to blame. That all those years, all the politicians and all the governments that dealt with the economy of Greece have made mistakes. During the 80s, we had a huge accumulation of debt. Since 1990, there was an effort to reduce deficits and stabilize the debt. This effort was not successful. As I said, the debt was stabilized at 100% of GDP, but one could have a much more ambitious target to reduce the debt back to where it was, say, in 1980, which was only 25% of GDP. We did not succeed in doing that. We did not succeed when we tried to enter the Eurozone, and we did not succeed after we entered the Eurozone. In fact, after we entered the Eurozone, deficits increased up until 2004. To talk about our particular administration, between 2004 and 2006, we made a big effort to reduce the deficit. We went to a deficit from 8% to 3%. This was not enough, obviously. After 2007, there was a relapse. We have to admit it. There is no reason to hide that, you know, the political system in Greece did not show the discipline that was required by a member of the Eurozone. And I would say that, you know, having been a finance minister for 5 years, and I know that Papantoniou has been a minister for many years and other ministers, that the ministers of finance are the last to blame if you were to start apportioning blame. Because the pressure that exists from spending ministers, from society at large, made it extremely difficult, and we are all very unpopular in Greece, obviously, because
populist,
we all try.
Unpopular, populist.
Unpopular.
Populist.
Okay. Let him answer them, please. Okay, thanks.
We are all very unpopular in Greece because we tried, as ministers of finance, to implement measures against the will of our governments and against the will of the people. Now, there was a question of the ability to pay. The situation right now is completely different from what it was even a year ago. Now there is a deep sense, a deep realization in Greece that we are in crisis. Society, I think, is much more ready to accept what is needed to correct the fiscal problems that Greece has created in the last 30 years. And this is the best hope, I think, for Greece, that now that there is a realization of the crisis, which did not exist even in the run-up to participation in the monetary union or after participation in the monetary union, where people thought that we could go on spending. The economy was growing, of course. Unemployment was falling in the last few years before the crisis. Now everybody realizes there is a crisis.
And I think that this is the best hope for the present government to implement its program. The program will not be popular, obviously, but no program of fiscal adjustment has ever been popular.
Okay, thanks. I think we have time just for two questions. There's a lady right at the very back on the left here. I'm sorry, I didn't realize the microphones were only at the front.
Hi, my name is Mary Stokes. I'm an economic analyst. My question is, what do you think is the likelihood, given the imbalances in the Eurozone, of Germany leaving the EMU from a position of strength rather than focusing on Greece leaving from a position of weakness?
Thanks very much. The gentleman in the blue here, please.
Because all the members of the panel have said that default or quitting the Eurozone is uncharted territory and they didn't want to go there, can we say that because it would be so complicated to deal with, the Eurozone, the IMF, and whoever else might be involved will actually do whatever and at whatever cost, if it's 100 billion, 100 billion, if it's more, to avoid it? I mean, can we safely, could that mean that to avoid the headache, they would do that? My opinion would be yes, but I was also thinking that the Eurozone would never happen because it would require a political union, so.
Okay, thanks. Perhaps just one very quick question, if.
Very quick.
Fine. I'm sorry, the gentleman here. Very quick.
Thank you. I'm a candidate for next week's elections in North London, the North London ward.
We can hear.
I'm a candidate, Constantine Buhaya. I'm a candidate at next week's elections in the London ward.
Oh, good.
And it doesn't matter, it's not...
Only one of these gentlemen has a vote.
And... and the question that keeps coming up...
Okay. A quick question, come on.
At hustings, there's one question that keeps coming up, and the question that was put to us is, as local government funding will inevitably be reduced in the next 4 years, and difficult choices will need to be made, which areas of services are most likely to be affected? And for Greece, is which areas are going to be cut and affect the ordinary voters? Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Can I ask Wim perhaps to respond to the question about whether Germany may leave from a position of strength?
No, I think that's... I cannot imagine that it could happen, though. The mood in the German population is not there, no. Certainly not.
Okay. Sorry, I was shocked by the precision and the brevity, but thank you. Simon, would you like to respond to the earlier question, which we missed, about the role of the IMF in this crisis, friend or foe?
Yeah. I'm also concerned about the participation of the IMF, but for very different reasons from yourself. I think the role of the IMF reinforces the perception in the markets that the Eurozone can't sort out its own problems, and reinforces the sense that this currency union might not be forever. It's worth remembering that were the IMF setting the conditionality for any bailout in Greece, the terms would be much less onerous than the ones that have been set by the EU IMF because of pressure from the rest of the EU. So be careful what you wish for.
Okay, thank you. Could I ask Yanni then to respond to this last question about where the cuts should come?
Could I hear the question again?
Basically, the question is simply, everyone's talking about cuts, where should they come from?
In public spending?
Yes.
Well, I suppose, cuts in public spending, first of all, should come from a complete freeze of recruitment. Should definitely come from the public sector wage cuts that the government has already instituted. And thirdly, and most importantly, must come from streamlining the working of the public administration, particularly in public corporations which are producing huge deficits, like the railways and others.
Thank you.
I just want to say a word about the problem of the IMF. I think that the problem of the IMF is important and valuable, because the IMF is the only institution that can provide immediately money for the support mechanism. All the other commitments that come from European countries will take some time to be implemented because of the political process in a number of countries. So it is very, very important that the IMF is in the support mechanism, as it has been agreed, because it is the only institution that can provide money immediately, and Greece will need money immediately. We'll need money during May. And the IMF is the only institution that can provide this money in this short period.
Okay, thanks. Now, this has been a very typical seminar for the Hellenic Observatory. We've had media coverage from France, Greece, the UK, internationally, etc. It's a normal Wednesday evening for the Hellenic Observatory. However, despite that, on your behalf, I'd like to thank our speakers very much indeed. Can I ask, I'm advised to just simply request that you remain in your seats whilst our speakers vacate the room. But again, thank you for attending. The very best. Thank you.